right. As you know, we have asked each of our speakers to give me a short bio with which to introduce them. Here's our final speaker's bio. Color me, former Rochesterian, retired college library director and lifelong collector, currently editor of the Blue Pages, the encyclopedic guide to 78 RPM party records, David Diehl. Not yet.
Technology triumphs, right? Good afternoon, everyone. The subject of my presentation today is record producer ELI OBERSTEIN, kind of segueing from the sublime to the ridiculous here. Because of the mythology that has surrounded him all these years, this talk has developed into something more of a documentary slideshow with some incidental narration, so bear with me. Let's see. Yes. Moving along. That's interesting. For those of you who may not be familiar with OBERSTEIN, he is one of the great characters of the 20th century record industry. In later years, record producers such as he would be referred to by musicians as a suit, a self-aggrandizing, shamelessly profit-seeking taskmaster. OBERSTEIN was the archetype, the ultimate source of the genetic dress code, if you will. He was born Elias OBERSTEIN on December 13th, 1901. This is his life insurance application, and he gives his date of birth about midway down. So we know he's not lying. Believe me, that's a very important point. He grew up in a working class household in New York City's Lower East Side. He stated that he entered the record business through the back door as a very junior employee of the S.D. Leidsdorf accounting firm, a very well-known business heeler still in business today. In the mid-1920s, they happened to be ministering to the Columbia Phonograph Company. Judging by his physical prowess, I suspect he would have made a good collection agent more than anything else. Apparently, Elias was quite a go-getter because by 1928, he was actually the treasurer of OK Records, which Columbia had acquired in 1926. And the date is July 11th, 1928. Ralph Peer produced much of the country and race music that OK was recording on field trips in the mid-1920s. Peer moved to the Victor Talking Machine Company in 1928. He drew no salary. He co-owned Southern Music Publishing Company with Victor, and they split the half-cent per side royalty on every composition placed with that publishing house, which was practically every tune recorded by Peer on his field trips. Peer's activities grew astronomically, and he hired OBERSTEIN away from OK in September of 1929. The Justice Department had conducted a long-running investigation of the Radio Corporation of America, which purchased Victor 2 months after his arrival. An antitrust suit was filed in May of 1930, and RCA was justifiably nervous about anything that smacked of vertical integration in the industry. Ownership of music publishers Leo Feist, Carl Fisher, and Southern Music became potential liabilities, and within months, Peer and Southern Music were out, and ELI was in. December 17, 1930, Mr. OBERSTEIN is noted as present for a McKinney's cotton picker's date in Camden, possibly supervising his very first recording session. He survived the 30s despite dismal record sales, probably by cozying up to Victor's new president, Ted Wallerstein. He acquired a middle initial and began to style himself E.E. OBERSTEIN in 1932. That same year, He joined the American Federation of Musicians under the name Elliot Everett. If we could have the first track, this is Elliot Everett asking the musical question, "Was I?"
A sweet young thing of 16 thought that she'd step out one night alone to get the thrills and life she'd had. She met a youth a bit uncouth, although he seemed all right. She'd known him but a moment when they kissed. When she got home next day with swollen head, and her girlfriend asked, "Did you have fun?" she said, "Was I drunk? Was he handsome? And did my mug give me hell? Did I get a thrill and am I still a quiver? Was he rough and did I care? Am I glad now that I fell? Every time I think about him, do I shiver? Was he hot and was I? And would he stand for maybe? He would not. Did I lie? Does he still think I'm a baby? If I was, am I still? Do I care? Don't be still. Was I drunk? Was he handsome? And did mama give me hell? Was I drunk? Was he handsome? And did mama give me hell? Were his hands loose? There's no use refusing. Did he fight? Do I bruise? I'm almost ashamed to tell. I don't know yet the system he was using. I said, stop, please behave. What's the use of raving? He said, give. So I gave. After all, what was I saving? Am I glad? Holy gee, have I had you asking me? Was I drunk? Was he handsome? And did mama give me hell?
He had found a niche where radio could not compete. Oberstein was especially effective on the budget Bluebird label, where he made a lot of sides by non-union musicians and in poorly unionized locations. He is widely, if briefly mentioned, in a host of biographies of jazz, blues, pop, and country musicians he had worked with at Victor and Bluebird during the 1930s. He departed RCA to begin his own independent labels in February of 1939. Now, my own investigation of Eli Oberstein began in 1978, and there was substantial coverage of him in the trade publications, enough to get a fair outline of his career, and there was a very self-serving puff piece called "The Man with the Golden Ear" in that ever-reliable magazine Saga, in January of 1960, came out shortly before his death. Harold Farberman has quite a bit of correspondence with Eli Oberstein in late 59 and early 1960. And one of the things that apparently Eli mentioned to him was that Saga magazine was 95% cockeyed. And yet this has served as the basis of a great deal of pseudo-biographical material on Eli Oberstein. Anyway, that seemed to be the end of the line for me. Ray Weil had recounted a fruitless attempt to gain access to the man for his article U.S. Records, A Study in Reincorporation. Eli wanted to write his own narrative, not quibble details with some nosy collector. Neither Eli's son Maurice nor former co-worker Ethel Gabriel replied to my inquiries. I met with bandleader Vince Giordano while he was working as a researcher at BMG, which then held the Victor archive, and he said, "Hey, if you find anything, let me know." Victor's cupboard was bare. So in 1998, after 20 years, I decided the time had come to publish what I had in the ARSC Journal and be done with it. So it rested until 2006, when I received an email from a woman who identified herself as the stepdaughter of Eli's widow. She had uncovered some of Oberstein's documents in the course of selling a publishing house she inherited, and subsequently found my ARSC article on the internet. She offered to send me a sampling. I was very, very pleased to receive a package full of these. Did I say I was very, very pleased? Some of you may recognize this as a carbon copy of a ledger sheet for a Bluebird session. This is from 1938, and RCA's original copies of anything post-March of 1936 have apparently been discarded. More paperwork arrived, and things began to fall into place. I began to get an understanding of what was going on when I got this. This is the settlement of a multi-part lawsuit between ELI and RCA with one Alton Miller, better known as bandleader Glenn Miller. The upshot of all this was that Miller gave ELI a dollar and was free of any obligations, and ELI gave Miller a dollar and other considerations. But the big winner was the RCA Manufacturing Company. It got a $10,000 payoff from Oberstein and the return of some 1,800 copyrights. On field trips, Oberstein had pressured artists to sign away the rights to their material. For instance, here we see, I'm sure if you can read it, but these are Cajun pioneers Dennis McGee and Amede Ardoin. He's the one with the X. And he was later beaten to death by some drunken white men after a dance, unfortunately. He's probably not likely to show up in autograph collections very often. This one is Clifford Boots Douglas, leader of a San Antonio dance band called Boots and His Buddies, and we will revisit him shortly. This is not too clear, but this is a country western swing practitioner, Smokey Wood, and we can follow the progress of his session from his original confirmation letter to these handwritten session notes, and here he signs away his copyrights, and finally the Bluebird log entry. Now, Dorsey Dixon was a fairly prominent Western recorder at Victor, or at Bluebird, and he has claimed that he was one of the most vocal in his protests over these copyright hijackings. And sure enough, attached to one of the bills of sale, I found this note. And down at the bottom it says, Dixon is one that caused trouble. Sometimes the scraps of paper used for notes prove to be almost as interesting as the notes themselves. For instance, here is a recycled picture music cue sheet for a silent film. These are the only copies of these things that have ever surfaced, as far as I know. Just in case Oberstein's disclosure proved to be less than adequate, RCA also had the right to get pertinent documents in the future, which explained why this treasure trove still existed. Now, these copyrights were assigned to three names: Pat LaBasse, about whom I know absolutely nothing; Lou Shank, which name is listed as co-composer on some tunes with Basil Ziegler, a longtime associate of Oberstein's; and Joe Harris. The first two, I expect, were merely Oberstein's pseudonyms. Harris was known to me as a trombonist and vocalist with the 1935 Benny Goodman outfit. But as with most things Oberstein, what I thought I knew was not the way it was at all. On a visit to the Hogan Hancock Jazz Archive at Tulane, Obie's Joe Harris was revealed in the digest of an interview with Lawrence Harris, who played trumpet with Boots and his buddies in San Antonio. It described how LD had transformed Don Redman's tune Cherry into something Oberstein could pass off as an original entitled Wild Cherry, and how LD himself came to be retitled Joe. He was just Joe, another guy, right? He must have done a lot of work for Eli, because the 9-page schedule of tunes assigned to him is by far the longest of those three names specified in the suit. Oberstein left Victor in early 1939, and there was a great deal of comment in the press surrounding his indie record venture and the fact that a number of important Victor artists had signed contracts with Eli himself. If we return to the settlement, we see that RCA held on to four of its major stars: Glenn Miller, Larry Clinton, Tommy Dorsey, and Eddie DeLange. Notably absent from the list of leaders who escaped Obie's clutches was Artie Shaw. In fact, a year earlier, in November of 1939, Artie was in a New York courtroom eating crow, as Oberstein's claim against him was partially upheld. Shaw was forced to apologize for certain undiplomatic statements he had made to the press, as well as repaying a $6,000 advance. Now, there was a stipulation in that settlement which goes far in illuminating the immediate course of the popular clarinetist's career. He was to repay $50 per week when he resumed working, according to the report in Variety. Shaw had abandoned his band at the Lincoln Hotel in mid-November and gone off to Mexico and spent several months there. Saxophonist Georgie Auld continued leading the remnants of the band, and in January of 1940, he made a record date with none other than Eli Oberstein and his new Varsity label. Could we have track two, please? By the close of the year 1938, almost every pop music listener in America could have identified this tune just by its intro. Unlike so much of the swing years of pop ephemera, this particular record had a lot of staying power. And this 1945 Billboard item, it capsulized the jukebox industry's view of the disc. And a run of 320 copies at a single location was clearly exceptional, we can understand why Shaw was able to negotiate some of the most lucrative recording contracts in the business. Now, Oberstein's hot pick for the session that produced Begin was a travesty of the Nelson Eddy and Jeanette MacDonald favorite Indian Love Call. It had textbook Oberstein appeal, an already familiar melody, plus a distinctive novelty hook. The band is singing Cheep Cheep in a zany falsetto throughout the opening, and that was followed by a fairly engaging vocal by Tony Pastor, and more silly interjections from the band, and then a swinging out chorus. In contrast, Shaw's pet Begin the Begin featured a very clean arrangement by violinist Generoso Graziano. That's Jerry Gray to you. And it was from Cole Porter's 1935 Broadway disappointment, Jubilee. It lacked the publicity that a current show would have generated, absent any ballyhoo from the publisher, and certainly no movie tie-in. Constructed in a highly unusual 108-bar form, which Porter himself said he could never play without sheet music, it was a waste of costly German beeswax as far as Obie was concerned. When I find out that one song has $50,000 behind it for promotion and another has nothing, I forget about the quality of the music and bet on the song with the $50,000, Obie admitted in a 1940 Time magazine article. In a 1992 interview with Bruce Talbot, Artie was typically direct. He said, "There was a guy named Eli Oberstein, a horror. He was a busybody. He was a pain in the ass. He would say, 'Why don't you try?' Saying the band do this and you do that. And I would say, 'Eli, for Christ's sake, go sell your records and leave me alone.' I never listened to him, but we tangled a lot. We fought quite a bit, but I said, 'Look at my contract. The contract said I could do what I wanted, and I did what I wanted.'" Obie ran the Bluebird label as a virtual fiefdom within RCA. He selected the talent, generally dictated the choice of material. He also forced many artists to sign personal management contracts with him as a condition of recording for his label, and Shaw was no exception. Other artists he snared included Sammy Kaye, Dick Todd, and Van Alexander. Now, after a stint in the Navy, Shaw returned to the Victor Recording Studio in November of 1944, and peace might well have prevailed had not Eli Oberstein returned from his indie adventures in April of 45 to once again head Victor's popular music division. By September of that year, Artie jumped ship to the up-and-coming Musicraft label, and in June of 1946, he embarked on an album devoted to Cole Porter tunes, which included, inevitably, a new version of Begin the Begin. RCA's legal department was quick to respond upon its release. Musicraft was understandably sluggish in its reply, but eventually a settlement was reached by which the 30,000 copies that were already pressed would be sold, but a new tune would be substituted for any repressings of the album. Seems like a pretty generous settlement to me. For proof that time does not heal all wounds, we can fast forward to June of 1953. Musicraft has fallen into receivership, its masters leased first to MGM, and then to the recently formed Record Corporation of America. Registered mail. The real RCA has discovered that the verboten 1946 Begin the Begin has been included in an LP produced by Eli. Oberstein, unquestionably the most astute and aware record producer in the industry, and he had been a top RCA Victor executive at the time of the original fracas with Musicraft, please complete ignorance and ask for documentation. When documentation is provided, he claims that it's the lessor's fault and he should not suffer any loss. July, then August, come and go with no satisfaction for RCA Victor. Eventually, Oberstein clears out his inventory of the offending disc, and the absence of Cole Porter's classic from later pressings of Allegro Real 1405 finally ends the Begin saga. However, arranger Jerry Gray was not finished with Eli by any means. After a stint with Glenn Miller, he went on to front his own band near the end of World War II. He recorded extensively for standard radio transcriptions. And when Eli leased a large chunk of Standard's catalog, some of Gray's work was included. It was released anonymously, but the arrangements were copyrighted, and Eli did owe him royalties, and eventually paid off. Okay, back to the early years. There is no paperwork in my collection from Eli's first venture, the United States Record Corporation.
Oh, Helen, please be mine. You simply are divine. You muddle me, it's true. Oh, Dan, oh, Dan. Oh, damsel, I love you.
Do you catch a certain theme running through much of his productions? Let's see what we got. One more time. In October of 1941, Eli was fronting a new operation he called Imperial Records. The Imperial name had to be dropped because of prior use of the name by a drag queen named Ray Bourbon. So the name Elite was finally substituted. Again, not much in the way of paperwork from this period, but I did happen across a very obscure Montgomery Ward product. With I prefix matrices that are definitely from Eli. Irving Riskin had been Eli's musical director at US Records. Too bad it didn't, oh, it's, okay. Looks different on my screen, so excuse me. let's see. The one paper I do have is an unsigned bill of sale to Imperial Records for a tune called There Was a Little Girl and This Is My Prayer. These were privately recorded in 1942 at C.P. McGregor in Hollywood by Walter Schumann and his orchestra with the Melody Maids. Schumann had come east to be musical director of the Armed Forces Radio Service, and he went on to compose the theme for Dragnet. And it explains an obscure quote by Obi in Time magazine during the Petrillo band. It's very simple, remarks Eli. I pick up any tune I like, and the records just come in. Well, most of those were scab sessions, but that particular tune just came in, apparently. More big news. Eli sells out his operation to Majestic Records and returns to RCA Victor as head of Artists and Repertory at the end of July 1945. There was no better way to commemorate the occasion than with a lawsuit. Oops. Makes sense to me. Although Oberstein had one of the most prestigious day jobs in the record industry at RCA Victor, he continued to moonlight in competition with his employer. He had become, in fact, the first semi-independent record producer. In August of 46, he is revealed as a silent partner in the Jukebox and Sterling labels. In December of 1946, a lone side from his Varsity label appears on Blue Note. Two other Varsity masters were released by Herman Lubinsky's Savoy label in April 1947. Oberstein and Lubinsky would work closely together in the 1950s as well. Stinson Trading Company also recycled some Varsity material in 1947. And since Jan Peerce's Red Seal recording of the Bluebird of Happiness was doing so well, it was only natural for Oberstein to lease some of his old Peerce material to rival Majestic. Milt Gabler got eight Varsity sides to bulk up his Commodore catalog in October of 47. And for variety, there were also some 1940 Kitty records that reappeared on Caravan in early 1948. Here we go again. So long, Nipper. I have shown these headlines of Obie's comings and goings with a purpose. There is not another record man who garnered such gigantic headlines in the trades. If you were to turn this page, you would read Columbia's announcement of its new long-playing discs. This is May 29th, 1948. It's buried behind Oberstein. Okay, on June 23rd, 1948, Sonora's mortgage at 48 Elm Street, Meriden, Connecticut, goes to Eli Oberstein, and the Wright Record Corporation is born. And one of his labels was a rack label called Meriden. That was launched in March of 1949. Very attractive sleeve, anyway. Music is, I won't be playing any more musical excerpts because Oberstein's output tends to go downhill from here on out. The Record Corporation of America was incorporated on May 8th, 1951, and Wright Records simply dissolved. He was clearly aware of the similarity of his Record Corporation of America to his ex-employer, not once but twice, the Radio Corporation of America. And he was no doubt delighted when the trade magazines snickered at the similarity between the two RCAs. Obie wrote to the legal department at the Radio Corporation of America. On his letterhead, the above letterhead is our corporation, and you can see that everything is spelled out, and there is no reason why anyone should confuse us with any other firm. And in fact, he was technically correct. The real RCA did get agitated when the general press began to confuse the two, however. Probably the most egregious misuse of the parallel was the case of singer Vivian Martin. The popular African-American publication Jet reported with evident pride that the 24-year-old Detroit soprano had signed a lifetime contract with RCA Victor. Curiously, a search of the Victor catalog does not reveal any evidence of this remarkable relationship. But a search of my archive finds a writer for Vivian Martin. She made one LP for Oberstein. Now, I'm not sure if, I guess you can see. If you look down at the very bottom of this document, you will see the signature of Edward J. Smith, legendary pirate of operatic recordings. Now, Eddie got Eli in really deep trouble. We don't know, there's no paperwork on any of this left. There may never have been any paperwork, but the Allegro label was sued for $50,000 by Sweet Regina Resnick. Obie had come up somewhere, presumably through Eddie Smith, with a whole bunch of pirated radio tapes from Germany, mostly from the Bayreuth Wagner Festival and some other things. So he came out with several boxed sets on Royale. After Regina Resnick piped up, all of a sudden, a lot of other opera singers began to listen closely and said, yeah, that's me, that's me, that's me. So all hell broke loose with that. There was also a Decca version of Madame Butterfly, which coincidentally shows up on one of his labels. So I really cannot tell if he was simply bamboozled by Eddie, who said, don't worry about a thing, everything's under control, or if he had some idea and just the idea that he could put out a box set, high prestige on a cheap $1.98 label, just was too much for him to resist. How am I doing? 5 minutes, all right. I'm talking faster than I realize. Let's see. Oh, yes, in 1955, Eli has released a disc of Chopin waltzes as performed by the late Leopold Godowsky. Now, pianist Jacques Abram claims the disc is one he actually made, and it is falsely labeled. Seems that Abram recorded some Chopin waltzes 5 or 6 years ago for Musicraft, and when that firm went into bankruptcy, Allegro bought some of its masters, which Oberstein subsequently acquired when buying up Allegro. Abram, through his attorney, is asking Oberstein for royalties and an accounting of profits. Now, I wish I could give you, a beginning, a middle, and an end for Oberstein, but the fact is, he just died in 1960. Carrying on as he always did, skirting, pushing, nudging, getting as close to the edge as he possibly could, not paying royalties to the Harry Fox organization. So I have a very nice list of all of his products as of 1959, because he has to enumerate every copyrighted song on those albums. Let's see, there was one more. If you saw the beginning, there was a Russ Case lawsuit, and that lingered on until after Obie's death. But if I read through the depositions, it's nice to see how things were done. Oberstein would drag Bruscase into the studio. They would have these tapes from overseas, the instrumental portions of whatever album they were working on. Russ Case would organize the chorus. They would sing in sync to this background music. They would have to do edits on the fly. And finally, after possibly 12 hours in the studio, the finished product, and out it goes, another $1.98 Rondo record. But Case had made an arrangement with Oberstein that obviously, once Oberstein died, nobody else knew anything about it, so he had to go to court and actually get scale for all the work he'd done, because Obie had paid him, you know, $100 here, $100 there, just to keep him going. But that was it. And Russ Case appends a list of these itemized things that he has done for Obie, and there aren't any intervening numbers. You know, these are just numbered receipts and, you know, business forms. He doesn't seem to have any other work than Oberstein, which is kind of sad in 1960 for a guy with Russ Case's talent. But that was the record business. As I say, there's no real beginning and end to Oberstein's career. He doesn't suddenly come to, you know, a change in heart. He doesn't become a better person. It's just Eli. And what you see is what you get. Thank you very much.
We're a little bit over, and if you leave, I understand, but if our speakers could come up, I'd like to leave a little bit of time for at least a couple of questions from them. If you have questions, are there questions for any of our speakers? Yes, Mike.
Yes, the Palophone in 1929 is actually not Hoxie. It's a guy named Hewitt or Hewlett. But Hoxie's 1922 Palophone is also an acoustical recording device, because he also had a cone with a mirror on the end. So, you know, he was playing back the films electrically. But in 22, he was recording them acoustically. So the multi-track version of the Palophone is electrical on both ends. And Hoxie was already out of that area around by 1924. So it's interesting, the parallel on both sides of the ocean, that Hoxie was doing acoustical film recording at the same time that Sven was doing.
And I thought his was mostly for recording radio broadcasts.
Well, that's the 1929. The 1922, he went to Washington, recorded Calvin Coolidge, recorded Jackie Coogan. There also were a bunch of folk recordings that he recorded for somebody, for some other producer. And that was done in Washington, D.C. On his way back from Washington, D.C., he stops off at Camden and demonstrates his stuff to Victor Talking Machine Company. And so there is a relationship there, and he goes back up to Schenectady, and that, of course, is part of General Electric is part of RCA. That part became RCA Photophone at the point when RCA and General Electric and Westinghouse had the split. But there's a lot of parallels there. And plus, you could probably do a hell of a lot of better playback of those 1929 Palophone films on your machines and the machine they built, hand-built in Schenectady.
Right, it was a pretty interesting project.
Yeah.
Nice piece on the internet.
Do we have, yes, John?
The Sonny Boy Williamson recording sheet that you had up there,
yes,
is actually from an artist file. It's not a Daily Ledger sheet. The Daily Ledger sheets disappear after 1935. They're not there anymore. But the artist files, while not always 100% complete, are there up until 1980s and sometimes later.
Yeah, the information is still there.
Okay.
Unless the artist file is lost. A lot of the artist files.
Some of the artist files are lost, and I don't know if that particular sheet is
But they broke up.
I'm only suggesting that you implied it disappears after 35. Yeah. The day-to-day recording ledgers do.
Right.
but not the art supply.
They broke up the day-to-day one.
They actually had simultaneously. They put, after 1926, they start making artist sheets as well as the daily ledger.
Yeah.
Prior to 26, they don't. Although they sometimes exist there too, because they're inconsistent. But from roughly January 1927 to December 1926 through the 1980s, they do the artist sheets and they do the reporting files. But the day-to-day ledger sheets. But the ledger sheets disappear after 35.
Except
yes, Gary.
Just a comment on the Regina Resnick incident. What Eddie Smith did is that was the 1953 Bayreuth ring cycle with Clemens Krauss conducting, and Resnick sang Sieg Linde in the Walküre. And what Smith did is he issued it under pseudonyms. None of the real performers' names were listed, and the conductor was one Fritz Schreiber who didn't exist. And what happened is Resnick heard the recording, and I think she heard it in a store, and she said, "That's me." And then proceeded to file a lawsuit.
Right.
So I have a question. I'm a little confused about the Artie Shaw begin on Music Craft. How could they sue him if he made a new recording?
His contract with RCA, and this was very common in the 40s, if you had a hit record, RCA's contracts would stipulate that you could not go and re-record your hits for another company should you leave.
It seems like that's not quite often.
It does happen. And there's an instance where Charlie Barnett had gone to some small label, I think it was Cardinal. And he wanted to do Cherokee and Pompton Turnpike and a couple of the others. And he wrote to Oberstein, and Oberstein said fine. Because, you know, the commercial appeal of a Cardinal record of Charlie Barnett was practically zero. But any advertising they did would go just as far toward promoting an RCA reissue of its old Bluebird size as it would to the new stuff from Cardinal. Shaw was a completely different ballgame because Shaw commanded this huge amount of respect in the industry, and people would just buy his stuff. You know, it was timeless. It wasn't some pop hit that would come and go in 20 minutes.
Yes, one more, Dennis.
Within the realm of classical music recording. I once had occasion to interview the violist Emmanuel Vardy, who made several recordings for the Royale label, and one of them was a Roller Sonata. I played it for him, and he said, "You know, I was 17 years old when I made that record, and the son of a bitch never did pay me."
Thank you very much.